Becoming Mike Nichols premieres on HBO, 9 p.m. this Monday. Joining us is the director of Becoming Mike Nichols, Doug McGrath. Thank you for joining us. Doug, Becoming Mike Nichols is the story of a man who did everything in show business. Started out as a comedian, headlined Broadway with Elaine May, became a director, did movies. He did everything, right?
He did. No, he did. He did everything wonderfully. You know, maybe he only went into what he knew he would do wonderfully, but I don't think so. He was an absolutely brilliant performer. He and Elaine, when people see the clips now, which is almost 60 years later, they're so fresh and so wonderful and so true and hilarious that you would think it would be enough for him to have just had that career. But then he went on to direct for the theater. The first two plays he directed were two giant smash hit plays by Neil Simon. He directed Barefoot in the Park and The Odd Couple. Mm. And out of that success, he got into the movies, and his first two films were Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf with the Burtons, with Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor, and The Graduate. Well, that's pretty good, isn't it?
Yes. Yes.
And that would be enough. That would be enough for anyone's career to have that on your resume, those things on your resume. And then he went on to do, you know, the Birdcage and Postcards from the Edge and Working Girl and Angels in America and his genius musical Spamalot and his, so many Wit for HBO as well. He just was a person of a wide-ranging intelligence, and luckily he had a talent that could support where that intelligence led him.
And somehow found time to have Diane Sawyer as his wife.
Yes, he managed to fit that in as well.
That's right. So Becoming Mike Nichols, he was born in Nazi Germany and the family escaped, came to America. He grew up bilingual. The family spoke German. He had to learn English, came home and had to translate for his parents. What is the movie about? Is it about becoming the genius Mike Nichols and
yes,
coming from
really
that background?
It's about, you know, when you have a career as long as Mike's and as full as Mike's, you can't, I mean, I don't think it's wise to do a documentary that covers all that, because when you have to cover everything, you have no time to really be on anything. You know, you're mm-hmm. It's 1 minute on The Graduate. It's a 1 minute on Working Girl, because there's so many things.
Right.
So early on, looking at the footage, and I know Mike felt the same way, even though we talked about, he talks with Jack O'Brien, who is his pal and who's in the movie with him. They talked about everything, meaning all the work, but the work that Mike really wanted to discuss at length, in detail, and with great enthusiasm and affection was the early work. And I thought, he's telling us, without directly telling us, he's telling us that that's what he wants the movie to be. And so that's what I made the movie be, so that we could spend 20 minutes on Nichols and May. We could give 18 minutes just to Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. We could give 21 minutes to The Graduate, whatever each, I can't remember how it each times out, but it's a lot of time on each thing. And what I hope will happen for the audience is that rather than racing through everything and getting no real feeling for anything, by the end of this, you will come away thinking, wow, that guy is amazing. You know, for people who know him, it's a reintroduction to the things they may have forgotten.
I really wanted the film to
work for people who didn't know him, so you give them enough time and they think, God, the Nichols and May stuff is hilarious, or, oh my God, that scene from Virginia Woolf, that's incredible.
Right.
But you couldn't do that if you had to race through and touch on everything.
Right. Everybody knows Mike Nichols, they just don't know that they know him. They might not know that they've seen all these movies. Did you know him personally?
I had met him a few times through the years here in New York, but I didn't know him. I mean, you know, we knew enough to say hello, but then it was only on this that we spent any real time together.
He passed away, I believe, in 2015, right?
You know, I'm terrible about years, but I think it was actually 2014. I think
because I'm friendly.
I think it was November of 2014.
Okay,
but I could be wrong.
You know what? And I'm name dropping here. I'm friendly with Nathan Lane. I went to see, is it Only a Play? Is that the name of the?
It's Only a Play.
It's Only a Play. Mm-hmm. And Louis C.K., I never go to premieres, but Louis C.K. is there. And he waves me over at the premiere. And I see a beautiful blonde mane of hair. And I look over and I go, oh my God, he's talking to Diane Sawyer. And Louis goes, I'd like you to meet Diane Sawyer and Mike Nichols. I went, oh my God, it's Mike Nichols. And I literally said, well, it's nice to meet you. And Louis gave the introduction, told them who I was. And I said, I don't belong here. I'm going to walk away now. But I got to shake Mike Nichols' hand. And I remember it was like October of 2014. I don't remember his dying that year. I remember thinking, God, I when he died, I did get to shake his hand. Was it? But I guess he died like.
No, I think it really was. It was near the end of 2014. In November.
Yeah, and they knew he had been sick, right?
I honestly don't know. People keep asking me this. I don't blame them. I would too, but yeah. I don't know the answer. He looked frail.
Well, how did you come about making this documentary? Was he doing interviews?
No. He was always a part of this. We all kind of figured it out together. And by we all, I mean myself, Frank Rich, the writer and producer, and Jack O'Brien, the theater director, who's a great pal of Mike's. And Mike, we all met. The idea kind of
did
came
Jack
out
O'Brien,
of...
Jack O'Brien had something to do with it's Only a Play, right?
He directed it.
Yeah. Okay.
And he was an old pal of Mike's. And when he heard from Mike that Mike had given up his plan to do his autobiography, Jack was understandably upset. He thought, oh my God, that's a lot of great stories that are about to not go recorded, mm-hmm. and somebody should record them. So he mentioned to Alex Witchell, the writer, who is Frank Rich's wife, he said, oh, I just heard the worst thing from Mike. This is so upsetting. And Alex told Frank, and Frank is very close with the fellows who run HBO, Richard Plepler and Mike Lombardo.
Hey, wait, but Frank said, Rich, for the people listening to the show, Frank Rich is Nathaniel Rich's father?
He is. That's one thing he is.
And I once stopped him on the street. I once stopped Frank. Frank Rich is, unfortunately, he doesn't write for the New York Times. He's with New York Magazine, and he runs, I believe, Veep, right, for Amanda?
Well, he was for the longest time the theater critic at the Times. Then yes. He was an invaluable political columnist for the Times.
The best. He was the best.
The best. I couldn't agree more. And he's not only the father of Nathaniel Rich, he's the father of Simon Rich.
And Simon Rich, yes.
And he is a producer of Veep, yes.
Yes. And everybody should buy Frank Rich's book on George W. Bush, which I can't remember. The greatest something ever sold. I can't remember.
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead.
Oh,
yes. Go ahead. I'm
anyway,
sorry.
Frank, knew Richard Plepler and Mike Lombardo, who run HBO, and he said, hey, what do you think about a documentary about Mike? And this is the great thing about HBO. They just are, if they see it, they're like, well, they're not like, who are you going to get to be in it? They're like, Mike Nichols, that's enough. Mm-hmm. Yes. And I had done a documentary for them about Jerry Weintraub. And it's
oh,
very
wow.
Happy.
That was great.
Thank you. We'd had a very happy experience with that. So I think Richard or Mike suggested it. Me and Frank and I knew each other the tiniest bit, and he loved the idea, so he called me, and that's how it happened. But I'm saying all that by way of saying, when the idea was brought to me, I heard how it had come about. So I always saw the film as a kind of filmed version of Mike's autobiography. It was a way for him on film to tell the stories that, for whatever reason, he wasn't going to write. Mm-hmm. And so that's why it has the sort of intimate personal quality it has. I didn't want, and Frank agreed with me right from the beginning, we didn't want other talking heads in the movie. We didn't want celebrities and other people telling their Mike Nichols stories. I thought, we have the real item, the real hot item, as Garrison Keillor likes to say on Prairie Home Companion. We have it. That's Mike Nichols. Let's listen to Mike talk about what he wants to talk about.
Right. Where did his wisdom come from? He went to the University of Chicago, I believe, right?
He did. He came from a very smart family, too. You know, his father was a celebrated, very successful doctor German. They were German, as you mentioned. He came from a cultured family, either, I think, on his mother's side, but it could have been on the father's side. But I think on the mother's side, his grandmother was the librettist for operas, including, I think, Salome. I forget which opera it was that's the best known. But so he came from intelligent people to begin with.
And they knew to get out of Germany.
Yes, they knew to get out of Germany. And here's a funny thing about how they got out of Germany. In those years, I think he came over in 38, but it might have been 39. In those years, you couldn't, to get into the United States, you know, to be admitted legally to the United States in those years, because of the Depression, you had to have an American sponsor who would agree in writing to support you for the rest of your life should you not find work. Frank's father, Mike's father, who was a doctor and a successful person, came first. He had someone sign for him, he came first, and then he found work and could then vouch for the family. Mike's mother remained behind in Germany for a while. She was an invalid. But the two boys, Mike and his brother, were sent over by themselves when they were 7 and 4 on an ocean liner. Mm. And it provoked one of the great stories of Mike's life, which was he spoke no English until he got here, but he had to learn a sentence of English on the boat because he was so cute. People kept coming up to him. Women on the boat kept coming up to him and kissing him. So he learned this. I don't speak any English. Please don't kiss me. So he got here. And, you know, I think the essential thing in his life happened when he got here, which was that he's 7 years old. He wants to fit in. You know, kids want to fit in. They don't want to be like outcasts or anything. They want to be just like the other kids. But to do that, you have to figure out what in is. What are the other kids like? And that's where I think he developed his acute sense of personal observation about people. He studied them to figure out why are you funny and what makes you smart and what makes you not that funny and you not that smart. And I think he carried that skill into his work as a performer, because his work as a performer is very specific, and certainly into his work as a director.
And being a director was what he always was meant to be.
It's what he was always meant to be, but I'll tell you this. I know many people, including my friend Woody Allen, who has a very precise and sophisticated sense of what a good actor is. And if you talk to Woody about Mike, one of the first things he always says is, that guy is a great actor. And he does not just mean a sketch comedian, though Mike was a brilliant sketch comedian. He means he was a great actor. And yet, what Mike says in the film was he certainly had that talent, but he felt that his stronger impulse was to direct.
Right. And he was not Elaine May's straight man. In other words, he wasn't directing Nichols and May.
Well, yes, no, but part of the reason they broke up is because that impulse was growing in him, and he tells this in the movie, he started giving her notes, and he said, that really wasn't, that doesn't make for a very happy partnership. You know, they come up together, they're great partners, they're doing everything kind of as a team, and then suddenly in the middle of their Broadway run, he's passing her backstage, and he's like, I thought you were a little slow tonight.
Right.
And I was like, yeah.
And didn't she get bored with it?
She did. Well, talk about a person. You know, it's hard to be smarter than Mike Nichols, but I think if I was going to pick anyone who might be able to be counted as smarter than Mike, it's Elaine. She has a brain of such uncommon quickness. You know, you look at their sketches, you're right. He is not the straight man. He is as funny as she is throughout. But the level of her comic invention is just breathtaking.
And she became a director and a writer.
Yes, indeed. And she directed, I think, two of the all-time best comedies in the history of Hollywood comedies or American comedies, A New Leaf and The Heartbreak Kid.
Right. Right.
Oh, The Heartbreak Kid. Oh, I could talk about that for 6 hours. We better move on.
Okay. And there was a great article in The New Yorker that I read. It must have been 1999. I used to keep it in my desk. I don't know where it is. It's a profile of Mike Nichols.
Mm-hmm.
He did suffer from some worries. He worried about money. I remember this.
Yes, yes.
I remember this. I haven't read this article in 16 years. He was convinced all his money was gone, and he would
temporarily. He was. This wasn't always true.
That no, and he would go visit his accountant, and the accountant would say, "You have X amount of money," but then he'd walk out the door and be convinced it was down to zero. The other thing that I remember from that article, and I circled it, and I always come back to it. It's a great quote, and it's true. Never tell anybody in show business what you really want to do, because then they know what to take away from you.
Well, that's very smart. Do you remember Project Greenlight?
Uh-huh.
I only watched the first episode of the first season, the first incarnation. And the poor guy who's been selected as the Project Greenlight director is at a meeting at Miramax. And he is talking to the studio executives about the film, and he says, "Listen, there are a lot of things that can change, but I'm telling you, the one thing that can't change in this movie is that it has to take place in that period." He wanted to make it, I forget if it was the 60s or the 50s, but he felt it was essential that it happen in that period. And I got a sick feeling in my stomach as soon as he said it, because I thought, okay, well, if we know anything, it's not going to take place in that period now. They are going to devote themselves to making sure the one thing you want goes away.
Why is that?
I don't know. It's a perverse business. But he's right. You know, Mike was very shrewd about how he played his cards.
Like Jack Warner wanted to be his friend when he was making, when Mike Nichols was directing Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. Jack Warner kept inviting him to the house, and Mike wouldn't go. And I think Jack Warner wanted it to be in color, and Mike Nichols insisted that it be in black and white and threatened to
leave.
Right.
Well, the color issue was a defining issue for Mike. Jack Warner was insisting that the movie be in color, because at that point in the 60s, everything was moving toward color. And I think he probably thought, you know, they used to resist color because it was so expensive. But when TV kind of came into prominence, and once TV started having color, they really couldn't have movies coming out in black and white. They felt they were going to get left behind. So he tells them, Warner says, you know, "I'm sorry, New York wants it to be in color." And Mike is very funny on this subject in the movie. But he said, "Well, it can't be in color. It has to be in black and white." They argue about it a little bit. And Warner's is like, "You know what? I'm sorry. That's what it has to be." And Mike said one of the great discoveries of his career was right then. He said, "Well, all right, if you want it to be in color, you make it. I like it at home. I'll go home." And all of a sudden, Jack Warner, who was nobody's pushover, said, "Oh, all right, black and white." And Mike said he realized right then, A, what his power was, you know, that he had a certain amount of power by threatening to leave. And he said, that's the way the old guard was. You just kind of went ahead and did it the way you needed to do it. That's not to say people didn't try to change his mind. His DP tried to change his mind.
I'm sorry. The old guard respected somebody who...
Well, they allowed it. They grudgingly respected it because they thought, well, he's willing to stand up for what he believes.
Did they take away...
But, of course, they were always willing to pounce if it didn't work.
Did he lose final cut on Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf? Didn't he get fired at the very end?
I don't think so. I mean, he doesn't talk about it. I don't think so.
I think on Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, he finished principal photography. He did like the first edit. And then when it came time for the final mix, Warner let him go. And then he discovered, well, that's the way it works. You get fired.
And I think he came back. I don't, to be honest, I don't remember. He didn't discuss it in the movie, so I forget.
I read somewhere, I can't remember. I think what happened was he got fired and then was told, oh, that's the way the old guard works. You get fired from your own movie. You still get to be called the director. But now Jack Warner is going to do the final cut. And then either the sound editor or the editor would call him on the phone and run the mix for him. And then I think Mike Nichols said, "I can't work this way." And he called Jack Warner and said, "I'll give up something. I'll give you all the money. if it's not. Oh, I know what happened. He was friendly with Jackie Onassis.
Yeah.
And they were worried that the Catholic...
Oh, yeah, that the Catholic League of Decency or something?
Yes, that they weren't going to approve of Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. He said, I promise you, when you screen it for the rabbis and the priests and the cardinals and the popes, Jackie Onassis will sit there and give it her blessing if you give me the final cut. And Jackie Onassis came and gave the film her blessing. Right? That sounds familiar,
yes,
right?
That sounds not only familiar, but correct. It's a very good story. We don't have it in the movie. I wish it was in the movie.
Very quickly, you've been very generous with your time. I can't wait to see this movie. Angels in America. If you don't know who Mike Nichols is, and believe it or not, it's understandable people wouldn't know who Mike Nichols is. You've just seen every one of his films.
Yeah.
People don't read credits, so there's
right.
No. Jerry Weintraub passed away, I believe, around the same time.
Yes.
There is somebody who got exactly what he wanted in life. One of the things he got was two women who loved him.
Well, not two wives, but a wife and a girlfriend.
At the same time. Is that, for a middle-aged man... working in show, is that possible, or is that, were they just saying that for the movie?
No, it's possible. I'll tell you what Jerry said, because I once was talking to a Teamster who had seen my documentary and said, God, the most amazing thing about him is he has a wife and a girlfriend. How did he make that happen? So I called Jerry and I told him that, and he said, give me the guy's number, I'll call him. So he called the Teamster. And he said, I understand you want to know how you get a wife and a girlfriend. Is that right? Do you want to know that? And the guy said, well, yeah. He says, all right, here's how you do it. The first thing you need is several hundred million dollars. So that's your first step.
Wow. That's incredible.
Jerry was such a great guy. I really miss him.
Who was Jerry? Explain, because if people haven't seen the movie, because I didn't know who he was until I saw your documentary.
He's rolling over in his grave if he could hear you say this. He believed everyone knew him, and Jerry Weintraub was an absolutely sensational music promoter who became an absolutely sensational movie producer. But really his greatest product, and he made many wonderful movies and promoted a lot of great music, but his greatest product was himself. He just sold Jerry Weintraub above everything. I knew no one. I have never known anyone like him. He was really a joy to know and to be friends with. And boy, was that a blow. I tell you, every day I miss him because, you know, we didn't speak every day, but we spoke a lot. And now when my phone rings, I have that thing of looking at it and thinking, oh, it won't be Jerry.
These guys do they get everything they want? Somebody like Mike Nichols. I mean, Mike Nichols, I don't think of him as, for example, a screenwriter, right?
He
wasn't getting up every morning compelled to put something down on paper, even though he was a brilliant comedian.
No one gets everything they want. I mean, don't you think? I mean,
Woody Allen.
You know, you think they get everything they want. It seems like they get everything they want. But when you dig right down into it, there's always a rosebud somewhere. I'm not saying people aren't happy. And I'm not saying
Marion Davis.
Not successful.
Wait, Marion Davis's clitoris? What does that have to do with...
the sled. The sled. You know, the sled. You know, there's always...
Wasn't that Marion Davis's clitoris, though?
Well... that is a rumor, but that was the nickname for that. I can't speak to it personally, thankfully, but that's a rumor.
Well, but Woody Allen, I'm not talking about personal life, but I'm talking about just in terms of a career. Woody Allen gets everything he wants. Larry David gets everything he wants.
Oh, well, maybe I'm misunderstanding what you're saying.
In your career.
I mean, they can do the work they want, if that's what you mean.
Yeah.
But then, having been friends with Woody for years, I know that he's plagued by even though he works all the time, he's always plagued by feeling he didn't get it right, that it could have been better, that it, you know, maybe next time it might be better, but very likely it won't, meaning this is him, not me. Mm-hmm. He feels there, of all the films he's made, I forget what the number's up to, but, you know, he thinks out of the 40-some films he's made, only seven came out the way he wanted.
Right.
He's not saying that the others are necessarily bad. What he's saying is that they, whatever they turned into, they weren't what he wanted at the beginning. That wonderful moment where you think, I know, I have a great idea. This would be a great movie. And then, like Annie Hall, famously, which obviously people love, is not Woody's favorite because he doesn't dislike it, but he just thought originally he had such an idea that it was going to be this thing, and for all kinds of reasons, it turned into this thing. And in his head, whenever he thinks about it, he just thinks, yeah, but it's not that thing. You know, the thing I first tried to get.
And you're friendly with Woody Allen. Are you able to talk to him without constantly thinking, oh my God, I'm talking to Woody Allen?
No, I'm not. I've been friends with him for 20 years? 20 years, easily.
How did you meet him?
I met him through I'd met him a few times in other circumstances, but I really met him through my wife, Jane, who had worked for him for many years, although when we started dating, she wasn't still working for him. But she had remained a very close friend of his, and so I started being included when they would go to dinner.
Wow. So, becoming Mike Nichols Monday night on HBO and the Jerry Weintraub documentary, what other films have you made?
Oh, Woody and I wrote Bullets Over Broadway together.
Oh, my God.
Though he really wrote it, but I was very pleasantly encouraging throughout. I wrote and directed Emma, Nicholas Nickleby, infamous, and His Way, the Jerry
You directed Nicholas Nickleby?
I did.
On Broadway?
No, film.
Oh, okay, because the Broadway play is still going. Wasn't that like the 3-day marathon?
It was. Well, you could see it over 2 days, or you could see it all in one day. And there is never, I'm telling you, it was one of the most thrilling theatrical experiences I've ever had, seeing that play.
Yeah.
It was just fantastic.
Oh, Ed, so go on, let me hear the other, so our listeners
That's
know.
That's it.
That's all?
That's it.
And what are you working on next?
I'm working on a new screenplay. Slowly making my way through the fog.
Okay. And did you work on the Broadway play Bullets Over Broadway?
I didn't. I was just, Woody did it himself. I was just a friend of the courts, so to speak. I came and saw how wonderfully he and Susan Stroman had done it.
You've been very generous with your time, but what is it like to write with Woody Allen? We always think of Marshall Brickman sitting with him. What is the process?
I have to say the thing that was so great about working with Woody is that he did not at any point, though he could have at every point, lord over me his vast artistic and intellectual superiority. I was so impressed by how he really, the only point of a collaborator is to get us another point of view. So he was always genuinely curious that I share my point of view, that I be honest with him if I thought an idea wasn't good. I learned so much from him, too, about how much he respected the audience in terms of, you know, studio executives tend to be afraid of the audience. They're always like, oh, you can't mention Eugene O'Neill. The audience won't know that. Well, Woody doesn't care about that. But what he does care about is that the audience is engaged. And he's always talking about, well, if we do this scene, it's kind of repeating what we did earlier. The audience will get bored. We don't want that. He's very alert to making sure that at all times, you know, the story was moving forward. And I was so impressed with his kind of ruthlessness in cutting, you know, and making sure that it wasn't repetitive or too long, because he talked a lot about how he felt each idea had a certain amount of time an audience would sit for that idea.
You know, Rick Santorum, the senator who just dropped out, went to Hollywood and became a motion picture executive for some Christian organization. And I never understood why he thought he could make movies, because the key to success in movies is killing your babies. And and I don't think...
Yes, that's against his policy.
It's against his... what did you learn from making this documentary about Mike Nichols? How did you become a better director listening to Mike Nichols?
I'll tell you the story he told that really impressed me. Unless I've already told you this. I hope I haven't already told you this. About The Country Girl?
No.
He directed a Broadway production of The Country Girl in the early 2000s. So late in his life and late in his career. He had won, I forget, 9 Tonys, 4 Emmys, the Oscar, you know, a giant in the business. And for whatever reason, that production didn't work. It was pretty widely panned. And Mike said that when he, you know, the reviews came out, they were pretty devastating. The business wasn't good. And when the show closed, that day he came home and he took out a yellow pad and he wrote like 8 pages of notes about what he felt he'd done wrong. I was so impressed with that story because he could easily have just been resting on his laurels. At that point, he could have thought, oh, that stupid critic, what does he know? He could have blamed somebody else. He could have put it on the cast. Whatever it was, he could have found a way not to face it. And if you have a career that lasts as long as his and you have the success he has, you have to face it, whatever it is, good or bad. You have to face it so you don't keep making that mistake. And I was particularly impressed with it because of his age at the time. It's one thing to do that when you're 22. It's another thing to do it when you've had every award in the world and you're in your 70s.
Right. What is the secret to longevity? Because I know that Mike Nichols... Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
He was not a fascist. He didn't believe in the auteur theory. He didn't like the Andrew Saris, the film critic for the Village Voice, had this idea that every movie you see has to be filtered through the zeitgeist of the director. You don't understand a movie unless you understand the director. And he maintained that wasn't true, that it was a purely collaborative effort. Is that the secret to longevity? Does somebody even like Woody Allen, who is, I think, is the ultimate auteur, if such a thing exists, does even Woody Allen think that it's all collaborative?
Well, I can't speak for Woody, but I think the Saris theory is a very interesting theory, and I think, like many things, sometimes it's true and sometimes it isn't. Woody is definitely an auteur, and when you see a Woody Allen film, it is entirely filtered through his sensibility, but that's because not only did he direct it, he wrote it, and he is a very active director in terms of every aspect of the film. So what you're seeing is the full expression of his taste and intelligence. But, you know, when you're directing somebody else's script, and if you're often directing different people's scripts all the time, I'm not sure that person is an auteur in the way Saris means. Meaning, then what Mike says is right, because the director is taking that. It is passing, that script is passing through the director's filter, so to speak. But it was still the author. Some other person authored that script and wrote those lines. So, to me, the auteur theory gets a little wobbly there.
One could even suggest that the producer in some situations could be the auteur, because it becomes a reflection of your taste less than your actual work, right? So what...
Well...
Okay, go ahead.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say there are very, very, very few producers. Really, I can think of David O. Selznick, but almost no one else who in any positive way could be considered the auteur of the film.
Harvey... Weinstein?
Oh, no. No, because he recuts things. When you're recutting someone else's work, or when you're making another person recut his or her own work, that's not auteurism. That's sort of a kind of tyranny. But it's not, there's nothing artistic about it.
Right. What is the, so in terms of log, just in terms of all your friends and What do you think is the secret to longevity? Do these guys worry about their next job? Or do they...
I think the secret to longevity is they're always looking forward. They're always going forward. Everybody has flops and hits. Well, not everybody has hits, but everybody has, you know, the most successful director in the world, Steven Spielberg. There are flops on his resume. There are movies that didn't make their money back, or there are movies that didn't get well reviewed. He never stops working. All of them, the people that really last, just keep working. And I remember a wonderful thing I read that Nora Ephron said. She said, you know, I get so tired of my friends who are screenwriters who complain that they're not getting their screenplay made. They're not getting their screenplay made. She said, so I always think, so write another screenplay. You know, you have to be so careful not to get caught up in something if it didn't work, because sometimes something doesn't work at the time and then is later judged to be wonderful. The key is keep writing, keep directing, keep turning out whatever it is you want to say. You have to keep going.
Last question. Nora Ephron, Woody Allen, Mike Nichols. Did they fight with people? These are people who have a storied career. These are people who just kept working. Do they fight with people?
What do you mean, on the set or in...
Yeah. Well, in business. Are these the kind of people who held grudges and said, I'm not going to work with this person, or you say they move forward and they don't look back?
Well, I didn't know Nora well enough. I knew Nora just the tiniest bit. You know, Mike in my film talks about how sometimes he didn't get along with the crew, or sometimes he and his DP would squabble. But, you know, so you have to, if you're a filmmaker, your only job really is to make sure you get the film you see in your head on the screen. And sometimes you have a crew and a cast that are united in their support of that goal. And sometimes, for whatever reason, you get a DP who has a different idea, or an actress who thinks she has a better idea. You know, you just get people who have their own ideas. And then you're confronted with how you deal with that. And sometimes you have to fight. Sometimes you have to fire that person. You know, there are all different ways around it. But the ultimate thing you have to do is make sure that your vision of what the material is gets on that screen. And sometimes that means fighting with someone, and sometimes it means letting someone go. That's tough. But in the end, as Woody always says, what's the point? You know, all that lasts, all that remains is the film itself. The arguments on the set, that all goes away. All people have at the end of it is the film. So you have to do everything you can to make that great.
Fantastic. Doug McGrath is the director of Becoming Mike Nichols. It premieres Monday night on HBO. Thank you so much for doing this. I know you've got a lot of interviews to do. Thank you, Doug.
It was a pleasure talking with you. Thank you, too.
Okay. Thank you, Doug.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.